Hi, I'm Chike Coleman from the Wheelchair Watcher. That's Chuck Koplinski from the Illinois Times and the News Gazette. And this is Real Reviews, the Cinematic Underground, the show where we talk about movies, television, and sometimes other stuff. And this week, we've got three movies to talk about. And it's been quite a couple of weeks, hasn't it, in the box office. Chuck, what do you think? What's been going on?
You've had one movie dominate each weekend. We're getting to the point, I think, where summer is not the only time where you have these incredible grosses. I think they've finally realized that there are only so many weekends in the summer, and they've started to spread big budget films throughout the year now, which is pretty smart.
And thank God they finally decided to spread the wealth, because we have been gifted with three really fantastic films to talk about this week. The first of which is the latest from James Mangold, entitled Logan, the third film in the Wolverine franchise, starring Hugh Jackman, Richard Grant, Patrick Stewart. I can't remember the girl's name, though. It's going to bug me. Stephen Merchant. It's just a fantastic film revolving slightly around the Old Man Logan comics, involving Wolverine aged, and it's in the near future, 2027 or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
Logan is worn down. He's a limo driver. He's kind of reluctant to be the good guy anymore. He just kind of wants to be left the heck alone. It's kind of very much like the old Western chain. He doesn't want to do the things that he's good at, but he's really good when he does do it. And I really love this film for its dystopian tone and Western feel. You have Logan being asked by a Mexican woman he's clearly met at some point in the past for help with her daughter crossing the border to a location, some Eden, with some coordinates, and Logan has been tasked with helping this woman and her child escape. Before that can happen, though, this weird army militia, which is led by Richard E. Grant's character, is coming after this girl. And so Logan has to both protect her and also watch over Charles Xavier, who's now in the late stages of what I will now call mutant dementia, which is causing his psychic powers to go awry. I'll be very blunt and say I love this film to pieces. It's brutal, it's very vulgar, but it's also deeply, deeply human, something we don't really, we haven't seen in the X-Men films for a while. It's all been about fantasy with Apocalypse and Days of Future Past. But this film is so grounded. It's got this alternate reality feel that feels so present within what Logan is going through. And even though there are brief uses of powers here and there, it's mostly a human story about a man trying to disconnect from his past, but also kind of connect to his present and see what's in front of him. And Charles Xavier helps in that as much as he can, even though he is losing his mind. But it's a very beautiful story about connecting and family, and how family can really come from anywhere. And even if you lose one family, there's always another family you can reach out to or be a part of. Chuck, what did you think of Logan?
A family you can reach out and be a part of if they don't get slaughtered.
That's true.
Never invite these people to dinner. This is never a good idea.
Yeah.
I liked it. I don't think I liked it as much as you did. I thought it was a little long, but it's finally a good standalone Wolverine movie. I was never too keen on the other two that had come before. And I think the whole key here, as you say, is the humanity. And the key there is, it's very simple in the title of the film. Wolverine is never mentioned. It's Logan, his name as a person before all of this started.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that gives us the indication right there. Love the scene. As you say, it's incredibly brutal, but I love the scene in which Xavier is having a seizure and everything is basically frozen within a hotel, and our hero has to genuinely struggled to get there to save the day. Great piece of little filmmaking there, that 3 or 4 minutes. Mm-hmm. And Jackman, you know, I'm sure that they'll eventually reboot the character at some point, and I just pity whoever has to step into those shoes, because I don't know how you're going to escape the shadow of him and bring anything distinctive to this.
Yeah.
It is his part. It will always be his part, something akin to Connery and Bond, I would think. Not that anyone couldn't do the part justice, but it's just become so identified with him. Mm-hmm. You know, it's hard to see anyone else doing it. So I will miss him in this role.
I will miss him too. I think the main thing that Jackman does that is so profoundly different about Wolverine is that every X-Men film he's ever been in, he grounds the film. And this being his final individual story, quote-unquote, on the final, it really showcases what he can do and the range he has. And it's finally great to see Wolverine completely go berserk.
Yes.
And just, like you said, destroy dudes in that slow-mo scene. Just the part where he's pressing the button to the elevator to go up to try and get to what he has to get to is amazing. And then watching him use his claws to slowly get to where he needs to get to in that destination, it's great. As you said, not a great character to bring to dinner when that character's being hunted. I wonder if the family knew what they were in for when they decided to invite them to dinner. Obviously not, but that film, that piece of the film, that section gave me so much sadness. More so than the final act itself. Just everything that transpired in that scene, in those scenes, was just heartbreaking for me. But I really do love this film. I know you say it's a bit long, but it has to have those slow sections in there to get to the next action set piece.
I agree, but we could do without one of the action set pieces. I mean, once you see the guy rip somebody to shreds and chop his head off, you've seen it, you know. You do without one of those scenes.
So could you toss the first action scene in the movie? Because I feel like that one's a bit tedious.
I don't know. I'm just saying. I think, you know, once you've done it a couple times, there's no need to do it again.
True. But, yeah, I love the film, Logan. I'm going to give it 4 out of 4 stars. You rated it, what?
3.5.
3.5, so we're close on that. The next film I want to talk about is Kong Skull Island. Now, I went into this film ready to hate it. Because it just didn't look that interesting to me from the trailers. I didn't feel like I was going to be involved in Kong's story. It stars, by the way, Brie Larson, Tom Hiddleston, Samuel Jackson, John Goodman, and it basically...
John C. Reilly.
I'm skipping John C. Reilly because his part of the film felt bad to me. That's the one negative. The comedic bits from him didn't feel natural to me, given what they were already facing, but okay. The film is about a guy who claims to be a geologist who wants to go look at this island that they've been tracking something very large on it, and they need help. And they go and they find this tracker played by Tom Hiddleston to try and see if they can find out what this thing is and maybe stop it. It's really under no real threat to them, but they've been seeing it for a while. I should mention that this film takes place in the 70s and that the first initial scene we get takes place in the 40s when two fighter pilots crash and are trying to fight to the death. And that Brie Larson here plays a reporter. So it's not really your typical damsel in distress, but it is a woman of convenience that happens to need to be saved, except she's not being saved by man, she's being saved by beast. Like I said, I wasn't really on board for this film initially, but then I started to watch it, and once Kong shows up, the whole thing turns around for me, because I realized what I'd been subtly hypnotized into watching is the 2017 version of a creature feature in the best possible way. You've got all these different creatures on the island that Kong is fighting and trying to protect himself from, while the humans are just basically watching in amazement, trying to figure out, okay, we need to destroy this Kong guy because he killed several of our men on the way in. And of course, that lust for vengeance is provided by Samuel Jackson, who seems to want to reprise his role from Deep Blue Sea in this film because he plays a colonel who has watched all of his men get slaughtered by Kong because they tried to fire at Kong and Kong fought back. I really, really liked this film. Just if you just give me all the Kong fight scenes, I'm on the boat and I'll stay on it for as long as you want me to ride it. But you got to give me a more convincing reason to be on that island. Give me a more convincing reason to care about the people who are taking this journey. Because really, I was just waiting for Kong to come back every single time. And when he did, I was in that driver's seat, just excited as can be. But beyond that, I didn't care. Chuck, what did you think of Kong Skull Island?
I really liked it. I liked it a lot. It was just big, dumb fun. And it's just amazing to me watching these effects. These digital effects and how they have progressed so quickly. You know, I have a young friend who is watching the Spider-Man movies now, and first Spider-Man was made in 2002, and she texted me the other night and said, why do these effects look so crappy? And I remember seeing Spider-Man and being wowed by what they showed me. Mm-hmm. But I suppose that in comparison to what we see today, that does look primitive.
Yeah.
And that's only 15 years. It's just remarkable. And that's really the highlight of the movie. I mean, all the creatures, the movement of them, you really get a sense that this thing is real.
Yeah, you do.
And you get a sense. And I love, there was certain shots, I love shots that gave us the scale. There's a moment in which Brie Larson is supposedly standing in front of him.
Yeah.
And you get a faraway shot and you see her compared to him. And that adds to the whole epic quality of this as well.
Or the opening shot with the planes as well.
Yeah, I guess. Yeah, I mean, I'm with you. The characters, you don't really care for too much because they're just stereotypes. I did think John C. Reilly was quite funny as the guy who's lost his mind. He's the World War II pilot we see at the beginning of the film and then pick up some 30 years later or 25 years later after this expedition comes by. Actually, it's going to be more like 30 years.
Yeah.
I thought he was a lot of fun. Mostly the people were there to run away and scream. You know, I didn't mind the story, but yeah, the characters could have been fleshed out a little bit more. But still, I really, really had a lot of fun.
I had a lot of fun with it, too. But I have one little bit of like a trivia, little quibble. Shouldn't Brie Larson be dead after falling in that water, then being scooped up by Kong, and then having to fight the big bad of the picture while Brie Larson is in its hand?
Sure, I guess.
Like that to me is a bit of a quibble. My favorite scene involving one of the big creatures was actually the spider.
That was creepy.
The ending to that spider was gross, and I just kind of dug it in that really, like, cringy way. It was kind of really great for me. I'm excited to see Kong versus Godzilla, because I want Kong to win that one. But then you've got Godzilla.
Did you stay for the end credit sequence?
I did, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we're going to get another Godzilla film, and then Kong versus Godzilla, and that won't be till 2020, so it's going to be a while.
It's going to be a while, but it's going to look fantastic by the time it gets there, because as you said, few years, that technology goes up a rung.
It takes a big leap, yeah.
So I'm really excited for that film. The third film I wanted to talk about today is the latest film directed by Bill Condon. That is Beauty and the Beast, starring Emma Watson, Dan Stevens, with the voices of Ian McKellen. I forget who played Cogsworth, though.
Emma Thompson's in it.
Emma Thompson's in it.
Stanley Tucci's in it.
Yeah.
This guy named Kevin Kline, I think, is in it.
Yeah, Kevin Kline.
And I think the Josh Gad.
Oh, yeah, and Luke Evans.
And
right.
Luke Evans, yes.
Yeah, my brain.
The
is
best Dracula no one knows about.
Oh, from Dracula 2000. Yeah.
Retold.
Untold. Untold, okay. Yeah, I did see that and like that one a lot. I was thinking you were thinking of the 2001. You guys know the story to this Disney movie. Belle is this kind of independent, free-thinking woman. Her father was an inventor in the animated movie, but now he's a music box maker. And he's going to sell music boxes, and predictably he gets in front of that castle. The beast takes him away. Belle switches places with her father. And then, of course, you know, gets trapped by the beast. And I'm not going to go over the whole thing because you guys know. Everybody's seen this. Well, almost everyone has seen the 1991 animated version of this movie. There are a couple key differences that I find interesting that I thought I was going to hate that I didn't like. They actually included the... Well, is that a spoiler if I say that?
I don't think so.
They actually included the fairy who actually cast the spell on the beast, and that actually plays into the film at a later point, that's all I'll say. And I like that. I also like the relationship between Gaston and LeFou. Thought that was really hilarious. Emma Watson is predictably kind and genuine as you'd expect her version of Belle to be, but there's one problem. I don't think she can sing. I don't think she's that good of a singer. I mean, I think there's a bias here for me because I'm so used to hearing Jodie Benson's perfectionist tones singing Ariel in The Little Mermaid in, what, 1989, and then doing Belle in 1991. I feel like her voice is the one thing that's lacking for me, but I also know that if it had been any more beefed up, that her voice had been any more strong, they would have felt, you know, overdone and operatic. But it just doesn't sit well with me. The ending is also something I didn't expect. I didn't get emotional about what happened at the end, but I didn't see it coming either. I enjoyed Beauty and the Beast because it's most of the time a shot-for-shot remake of the original, and it feels genuine, but again, I have the bias of having seen it before, but I think new audiences will love it. Chuck, what did you think of Beauty and the Beast?
I'm kind of on the fence on it. It's too long. It's way too long.
It's 2 hours this time around.
It's 2 hours and 9 minutes. Jeez. And before it was 86 minutes. It's too long, especially for a film that you're going to bring your kids to and have them sit through. I think there's, what, two, maybe three extra songs?
I heard four.
Yeah, and then a dance sequence here and there, and the camera, it's just too much. I've never seen the Broadway version. I believe they made a Broadway version.
They did,
of this.
Yeah.
And I thought I read that a couple of songs from that have been included. So I think that that's really the touchstone here, not the animated film, which is a shame because most people are going to have the animated film in their mind, as you say, when they go into this thing. I just came away basically saying to myself, well, they should have just left well enough alone, in my mind. And she's no Belle.
Yeah.
Yeah, she's just too bland. She just doesn't have it. I don't know what her role is now after Harry Potter. I know she's made some films.
She has a couple.
But nothing that has really jumped out and shown me, wow, she's a great actress. And this one, isn't it? And you're right, her voice... It's just not what it should be. If you're going to have a musical this big, you need a big voice.
Yeah.
And she's just not there.
You know, I was thinking about this yesterday before we were going to shoot this episode. And I said, who do I think would be a really great Belle for this movie? You know who I thought of? Hailee Steinfeld.
See that?
She's actually got a really decent voice. She's recently signed some sort of record contract. And I heard one of the songs when it was on, I think, Jimmy Fallon or SNL, and it was pretty good. I thought she'd be perfect for this film.
I think can see that.
Emma Watson was horribly miscast. I know that's who people had in their minds for Beauty and the Beast for the longest time, but I'm sorry to disappoint your fans. It just did not work.
I thought the Beast effects were good, though.
Yeah.
They were good.
Yeah.
And Stevens, it's kind of rough to, I'm sure, convey any real emotion. Still, he did what he could, and the effects were good.
Have you seen him in Legion?
I have not. I've seen him in other things before.
He's quite good there. There are a couple other things I want to discuss quickly. Oscars. How did you feel about the ceremony overall and the surprise at the end with Best Picture?
The show was too long.
Agreed.
Yet I was entertained by it throughout. And some of the bits went too long, but the bits where I thought were very good and imaginative. That whole tour bus thing I thought was great.
Yeah.
I've never been a fan of Kimmel, but I thought he did a fantastic job. He kept jokes coming, and they were mostly, he had more hits than misses, I think.
I agree.
He kept things moving along as quickly as possible. I love this running thing with Damon that carried over into that.
Yeah.
I love the thing, I think we've discussed this, where you had an actor or actress talking about an older film that impacted them.
Yeah.
And then coming out with a performer from that film. I thought that was great.
Yeah, that was really great.
And I hope that that's something they continue in years to come. The ending, well, what can you say? Those two people from the firm will never be back at the show, they've said. I'm quite frankly surprised that Pricewaterhouse has kept that client.
Yeah, I am too. I was actually happy with the Best Picture winner.
Oh yeah, I had no problem with it either.
And I was really happy with Supporting Actor and Supporting Actress. Lead Actor, I don't know. I didn't see Manchester by the Sea, so I can't really comment. Do you think it was worthy?
I think Denzel got rooked.
Okay. Yeah, he was my pick for a lead.
Yeah.
And I was really happy about foreign language film. I don't know if you've seen The Salesman yet.
Mm-hmm.
But if you should happen to see it, it's fantastic. It was at the Art for a few weeks running, and I just thought it was a really great film. Slower than A Separation, though, so be prepared for that.
Yeah.
The other thing I want to talk to you about is two things, actually. One, The Flash. Have you been keeping up?
Yes.
What a way to go with that. Oh, man. I don't know whether I want to go with Wrath of the Savitar or Into the Speed Force. Let's just do both. Wally is an idiot. Can we just say Wally West has become an idiot?
Well, that whole impulsive teenager thing.
But don't you feel like Barry echoes that as well?
Wally is a bit irritating. Yeah, I'm not defending him in any way, shape, or form, but I don't think Barry... I think Barry's come a long way since the first season as far as his behavior and his handling of his powers. But, yeah, Wally's got to snap out of this, or else they're just going to have to kick him out because he's causing too many problems.
I agree. The moments in... I should say, Wrath of Savitar was the episode involving Wally getting sucked into the Speed Force and tricked by Savitar. Because they were trying to get rid of the Philosopher's Stone. Harry Potter. I'm sorry, I had something in my throat. Mm. That was kind of interesting. I don't know. I mean, I feel like the show still has many, many legs left to stand on. It's just, where else can they go that would make sense?
I don't know. I think they've got to start exploring some of his more classic villains. And I hope that's something they do next season.
And bringing in more heroes that we don't know about. I mean, there was a brief glimpse on Earth 19 of Accelerated Man.
Sure.
And I thought that that was interesting, but we didn't ever get to see the actor or anything like that. Mm-hmm. But I feel like the show is heading toward a trick. Like, the person about who will die in Savitar's Prophecy, I think that's Joe West.
Yeah.
I honestly think that's Joe West. There's no one else it could be. Unless you really want to do the dumb thing and kill a Harrison Wells for the third season in a row. I don't know. I mean, that's just the way I see things. I think that The Flash is still going in positive directions. I like all the character dynamics. Cisco has improved from being the douchebag he was for the first, third of the season, maybe?
Mm-hmm.
And Caitlin Snow and her Killer Frost powers and her emotional dealings with that, as well as Julian. All that stuff's great.
Like the addition of Julian.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was a little worried about him at first, but I like what they've done with that.
I hope he sticks. Yeah. I hope he sticks around, because I like that character as well. The last thing I wanted to talk about, there was a little brief announcement made earlier this week of EbertFest 2016. We have... 2017. I'm losing my mind on the years now. EbertFest 2017 has announced two new guests, and those guests are Chuck.
Norman Lear and Isabelle Huppert.
Now, why is this important to EbertFest as a whole? Why are they important? I think you would be better to speak on that than me.
Well, these are two major players. Norman Lear was so significant as far as television. Throughout the 70s, All in the Family, The Jeffersons, One Day at a Time, many groundbreaking sitcoms. And there was a documentary made about him last year, which is going to be the focal point at EbertFest, which is what they're going to show. And then he will be there to discuss that and I'm sure a myriad of other things after the after that movie. Guy's 94.
Yeah.
94 years old. And I've seen and read interviews with him recently in relation to this movie. still very lucid, very intelligent. That's going to be an interesting Q&A.
I would assume he's going to be at one of the morning panels, and that's what I'm excited about.
Isabelle Huppert, I'm trying to get some sort of comparison to an American actress so that I can drive forth the impact of having her here. She's been nominated for 16 César Awards. That's the French version of the Oscar. She holds the record. I guess she would say she is the Meryl Streep of France as far as awards are concerned, but she's always been a bit more intense than that. I would compare her to Garbo, really, as far as her approach to the cinema. She always has a very cold demeanor to her, but you can tell there's a humanity inside her. She was in Elle, and they're going to be showing that at the Ebert Fest as well. That should prompt some good conversation, because it's a controversial film. It's a very manipulative film. Everything I've read about her and seen interviews with her and very intelligent woman. So I don't think that people are going to realize how major of a star this woman is walking around the cornfields of Champaign, Illinois. I can't really get over the fact that they actually scored her and she's coming.
I think
this is huge.
Yeah, I feel like it's huge. I would love for a Middle Eastern film to make it part of Ebertfest this year. That would be great, because of course, Ebertfest is known for doing international films. They always do ones from countries of Asian descent, but I've not seen a good Iranian film there since maybe Thieb, or there was another one with a girl on a bicycle that I can't remember.
Yep, I remember that too. It was really great.
Those are the last two in recent memory that I can think that I was completely moved by. And I kind of am having a love-hate relationship with them going with the more modern films now, because the more modern you go, the more likelihood it is that it's come to Champaign at some point. And the more further in the past you go, the less likely that's true. So I'm hoping for some good old films. Like you, I'm really anticipating the silent film this year, whatever that ends up being, with the full orchestra. It should be a good time. I just don't know what possible other people could be coming. What would you like to see? I should ask that question.
I'd like to see Patterson here. And if you can get Jim Jarmusch and or Adam Driver, I think that would be great. I'd love to see that. Because that has not gotten the play it should or the notice it should.
Yeah, I'm actually wanting to see Patterson as well, and I've heard a lot of great things about it. That's all we have for this week. Chuck, what's coming up next week that people should care about?
Trainspotting 2 is coming up next week, and that's what people should care about.
Okay, well, in earnest of that, I'll watch Trainspotting 1 so I can see T2 next week. Until then, I'm Chike Coleman from The Wheelchair Watcher. That is Chuck Koplinski from the Illinois Times and the News Gazette. We will see you next week. Bye, guys.